In this video, I'll quickly recap the action potential in neurons and show you where the absolute and relative refractory periods start and end. Refractory periods are where action potentials are either impossible or harder than normal. Then at the end of the video, I'll give you one cool and super important reason why you should care a lot about refractory periods. You ready? Let's do it. Welcome to Physio Flip. An inactive neuron typically starts at a resting membrane potential of around minus 70 millivolts. At this membrane potential, all voltage-gated sodium and potassium channels are closed. But to help us keep track of these channels a little bit easier, I'm going to put a little key here in the corner. Remember that the channel that has an activation gate and an inactivation gate is the voltage-gated sodium channel. This one, drawn with just one gate, is the voltage-gated potassium channel. When the neuron's at rest, when the activation gate is closed, I like to think of the voltage-gated sodium channel like a closed door. While it's closed, if we pull hard enough, we can open it. Well, the way to pull this sodium channel open the activation gate, and start an action potential is by making the inside of the cell positive enough to about minus 55 millivolts. If we reach this threshold value, we can see that the sodium activation gate opens, allowing sodium to enter the cell, depolarizing the membrane, making it more positive. At this point, I like to think of the sodium channels like a door that has been swung completely open. But since these channels are as open as they can be, we cannot open them again during this stage. They are currently completely busy. Think about it. If you just open this door right here, and then someone asked you to open it again, you would probably say, I can't. It's already open. Same thing here. If the voltage-gated sodium channels are already open, but we wanted to open them again to start another action potential, the neuron would be like, I can't. They're already open and totally busy. So I'm going to color these voltage-gated sodium channels and this depolarization phase red to help us remember that the sodium channels are busy and cannot be used to start another action potential during this phase of the current action potential. By the way, remember that the voltage-gated potassium channels are still closed during this phase. Eventually, though, we have to end the action potential to get this neuron back to rest. That's the job of the inactivation gate. It's going to close, blocking the sodium channels and preventing more sodium from entering. Remember that also what happens is that the voltage-gated potassium channels open, allowing potassium to leave, repolarizing the cell by making it more negative again. The voltage-gated sodium channel is now inactive, since that little ball and chain, the inactivation gate, is blocking the channel. In this inactive state, I like to think of the sodium channel like a door that is locked. Not only is it closed, but the inactivation gate will lock the channel and prevent it from opening no matter what. So I'm also going to color these voltage-gated channels in this phase of the action potential red, which will help us remember that these voltage-gated sodium channels are locked, shut down, and cannot be used to start another action potential during this repolarization phase. And in fact, this entire region that I highlighted in red, from minus 55 back to around minus 70, is known as the absolute refractory period. The word refractory sounds like a fancy word, but I like to think of it as another way to say the word resistant. So if a part of the neuron is in the absolute refractory period, this part of the neuron is absolutely resistant to starting another action potential, no matter what. We saw that during depolarization, when the sodium channels are wide open, we cannot start another action potential because the sodium channels are already open and they are fully busy. Next, when the cell is repolarizing and getting more negative again, we saw that the inactivation gate is blocking or inactivating this channel. In this state, the channel is locked and cannot be opened by any stimulus, no matter how strong. By the way, if you're curious as to why the inactivation gate cannot be opened, check out the comments below. We're going to have to wait a bit more before we can start the next one. Around minus 70 millivolts, though, the lock on the sodium channel gets unlocked, and the channel resets to its original shape. You can see that this sodium channel looks the same as it did at the beginning. As a result, starting here at around minus 70 millivolts, we can now start another action potential again, even though the current one is not yet over. So the absolute refractory period is finally over. But while we can start another action potential, it's gonna be a bit harder than normal. This is because the voltage-gated potassium channels have remained open, allowing more potassium to continue to leave the cell, making the cell hyperpolarized or even more negative than the resting state. Eventually, all voltage-gated channels do close though, and reset to their original shape as a result of this hyperpolarized negative state. During this entire region I highlighted in white, the hyperpolarized region, it is possible to start another action potential, but it will be harder than normal. Here's why. If we are at minus 90 millivolts, for example, it's gonna be much harder to reach the minus 55 threshold compared to if we were starting from here at minus 70. The potassium leaving and hyperpolarizing the cell has made it so much harder and will require a much stronger stimulus for another action potential to start. That's why this region, from about minus 70 back to minus 70, is called the relative refractory period. The membrane is relatively, but not absolutely or not totally, resistant to starting another action potential. When we finally return to the normal resting membrane potential of minus 70, we end the refractory period and a normal regular stimulus can take us to the minus 55 threshold once again. All right, I know what you're thinking. Who cares? Why are you talking about these refractory periods? Why do I need to know this? This is so stupid. I hear you. I feel you. But let me give you one good reason why you should care a lot about these refractory periods. If you've ever been to the dentist, you know it can sometimes be painful. They've got needles, they've got picks, they've got hooks, and they like using them. For this guy on the table, it might get ugly and it might get painful. For procedures that might cause pain though, dentists often use this drug called lidocaine. It works by preventing the cells from firing action potentials. And it's supposed to do that by making the cells resistant or refractory to being stimulated. So let's see how lidocaine works. Lidocaine is a drug that binds to voltage-gated sodium channels and keeps them in this locked, inactive state where the inactivation gate is closed. However, we know that if the sodium channels look like this, another action potential is not possible no matter what, because these sodium channels are absolutely refractory and absolutely resistant to starting another action potential. So let's look more closely at a neuron treated with lidocaine to see how it works. You can see that this neuron has all its voltage-gated sodium channels inactive due to lidocaine being present. That means that even if the neuron receives a very, very strong stimulus, for example, a lot of neurotransmitter being released, or the dentist cutting into your gums with a knife, no matter how strong the stimulus, these neurons will not get active and will not send action potentials to the brain. But if your brain never receives the signal that damage is being done to your mouth, you will not feel or perceive that pain. So, thank you, lidocaine and the absolute refractory period, for helping us get through our painful dental visits.